wanted to start out with the debt ceiling. And, you know, it was a long, arduous debate, obviously. And what was it that became palatable to you and acceptable to you? And when did this bill look like something that you could support?
Well, it came together. It had been working on it for a while. But once they start negotiating, that's really what brings it together. You have to negotiate. So I was advocating for 3 or 4 months ago, please sit down and talk. My Democrat colleagues and friends were saying, nope, we have to have a clean debt ceiling. Well, I've been here 12 years. I never recall having a clean debt ceiling when you have a divided Congress, when you have either the House is controlled by the D's or the R's, or the Senate on the opposite side. They've always sat down and talked. The only time you don't have much negotiation is when the president is of one party and both the House and Senate are the same party. So if you have all D's or all R's, there's not much to debate because the minority doesn't have much input. So I kept thinking, this don't make sense at all. We've always negotiated, so let's negotiate. And then when Kevin McCarthy was able, in a very, very divided caucus of Republicans over there with some really strong personalities pushing him in different directions, further right, they didn't think he'd ever get anything out. When he was able to succeed and get a piece of legislation that basically a deal that they put forward, then it's serious now. Now the president has to sit down. You can't have one side doing what they're supposed to do and no one recognizing that. That's when it really got serious. I wish it would have happened a lot sooner. We should never go to the brinksmanship of giving a lack of confidence to the world, if you will, where the reserve currency of the world is a U.S. dollar. And that means they have to have confidence in their banker. We're the banker.
And you clearly have a big voice. I mean, did you tell the president, did you tell the speaker this? That why go to the brinksmanship?
Oh, I've been speaking pretty ferociously on this. It needs to be done. And I was applauding both sides. Now, what I saw happen was something I haven't seen for 12 years, that basically they worked together. The Republicans knew they had a divided, they had a very small majority, and they weren't able to keep all them because there were so much demands from two, what I call the extremes. The extreme left and extreme right. Extremes in any type of a public policy or any people in public policy is not going to get a good outcome. Extremes are not going to do that because they're ideologically, they're pretty much set in their ways. They're going to fight for their position. And it takes moderate understanding as a give and take. That's how we got something done. And when you think about, for the first time, I never saw this, the Republicans coming out of the Rules Committee to put the piece of legislation they had agreed, negotiated, to the floor vote, had to come out and had to be an acceptance on the full body of the Rules recommendation. It only came out of the Rules with one extra Republican voting for it. So it was pretty well split up coming out of there. And it took about 25 or 30 Democrats to get it over the Rules Committee, to get it to the floor to vote that night. And then it was about split. I think there was 149 Republicans and 157 Democrats that voted for it. So that's what I used to read about, and I heard about Tip O'Neill and President Reagan used to sit down and work things out. You know, now it almost, if a Democrat controls Congress, they want at least 218 Democrats to vote for everything to get something done, or vice versa, Republicans. That was the old Dennis Hastert rule, and I never did agree with that. I thought you should basically always have a bipartisan movement. So when people talk, get rid of the filibuster, you get rid of the filibuster in the Senate, you'll end up no different than what the House is. There's no need to have the Senate. So that keeps us we have to make it bipartisan in the Senate because there's very seldom times in history where you have 60 senators of the same party.
Yeah. What benefits did you see with this passage of the bill for West Virginia?
Well, for West Virginia, all of them. First of all, we protected Social Security and Medicare. Social Security and Medicare is protected. And that's about 60% or 70% of my population. That's a big part. I have an old elderly population that's worked hard, retiring, that depend on their Social Security and Medicare. We were able to protect that. And then looking at how do we get our finances under control. We started a downward trajectory. Not as much as you like to see or not as much as we're going to have to do, but we have to get our financial house in order. We're carrying more debt, public debt to GDP, more so than when at World War II, percentage-wise. We were fighting to survive fascism. We were fighting a world war. and supplying, and we were arming the rest of the world to fight with us. We've incurred more debt now than we did then. This is voluntary because of things people want to spend. That was life or death necessity. So it makes you wonder, how did we get so much debt so quick? So I think we're moving in the right direction. We're basically saying, no, you have to be, you're going to have to be disciplined enough to live within your means. Every person that's watching us now has to make those decisions in their personal life. Every person who might have a small business or being at large conglomerate, they all have to be cognizant of where their financial wherewithals of their company. And the government should be the same. When I was governor of West Virginia, we had balanced budget amendments. I just sit down with my budget team every week, and they told me if we were going to be out of sync or not. If we did, they put a warning. After I got the warning, then the next week we didn't see anything changing. We were going in the wrong direction. I had to make adjustments and make decisions. That's a balanced budget amendment. We don't have that in federal government. And I've heard all that.
Should you?
I think that if people have been talking, why do we have this debt limit? Why do we always go to the brinksmanship and almost come to a default, which would be catastrophic for not only our country, but for the world? Well, if you want to look at doing something different, do a balanced budget amendment that keeps you in balance all the way through the fiscal year. If you're making adjustments accordingly to where you are, or have a risk management team. The SVB bank failure, one of the big things, they never had a risk manager on site. There was no one there saying, we're over-leveraged here, we're out of sync here, we could have a problem coming. They didn't look at that. They weren't warned or advised by it and made some pretty bad decisions. We saw the outcome. They're gone. The federal government should have some sort of a risk analysis, a risk team. A risk that has to come boom, boom, boom. And if you want to get rid of the debt ceiling, thinking that we're always going to pay our debts, then you should have a balanced budget amendment. Sure. So there's some things you can do back and forth and at least have good discussions.
Let's switch gears, sure. And this kind of goes into the area of what you just talked about, the divisions in this country politically. Mm-hmm. But you've been described as a centrist, as a conservative Democrat, as a moderate. How do you see yourself? And I ask that question in the context of the Kennedy placard you have in the hallway where, you know, nor a Democrat or Republican. Yeah. How do you see yourself? Because you're always defined.
I know.
But tell me how you see yourself.
Yeah. There's an old saying, you better tell your story before someone tells one on you, right? Well, the bottom line is people that don't know. I've never seen the parties as being supposed to be enemies. I didn't grow up thinking, well, why is my grandfather, I'm a Democrat probably because of my family. Okay, my grandfather was a Democrat, my father, all my family. Why were they Democrats? I would assume my grandfather's Democrat because of FDR. Great Depression. He had five little kids he was trying to feed and gave him a chance, saw a better quality of life, a better opportunity. So that loyalty factor. But what never was, I never heard my family say, Republicans are enemies. They're bad people. They were our best friends. You know, I mean, we never had arguments about that.
But they knew you were Democrats, the Republicans.
Anybody knew that the family was a Democratic family, but was a very centrist, moderate, middle of the road. And we never had any loyalty except to our government. There was no loyalty to the party. I don't forsake my responsibilities as an American or my oath of office to the Constitution because the Democrats want me to do one thing or Republicans want you to do something else. I never subscribed to that. So now it's foreign to me. And I guess I've always lived by the premise that I've never met the first person that's always wrong. I've never met that first person that was always wrong. I might have walked away too soon and not got enough knowledge because I didn't work hard enough, but I guarantee you they had something to offer. So you accept that, you're going to make things happen. Public service is that. So I'm an independent, I guess. I'm just purely in an independent.
With Democratic leanings?
Democratic leanings on certain things, Republican leanings on other. I say this, it's the best way to describe myself. I'm fiscally responsible and socially compassionate. And I think most Americans fall in that category, where they have a D or an R by their name or an I by their name.
You've been lobbied quite a bit, and I've read this over time, to join the Grand Old Party.
Yeah.
You've even had Governor Justice. You've had Senator McConnell, others who've leaned on you, Ted Cruz, I read, they all leaned on you. Talk about those conversations that you had with them.
Well, it's the only thing that I tell them all. I says, guys, do you think that's going to change the way I'm voting now? Just because I have a D by my name, but you know I vote very independently. Do you think if I would change to have an R by my name, that I would not vote as independently as I'm voting now? I'm not thinking you'll be any happier with me than what a lot of the Democrats are unhappy with me. The bottom line is, the parties have gone from where I've always known them to be, center left, center right. Now they've gone extreme left and extreme right. They seem to be more pressure from the extremes than there were from where you came together and made a deal or made a policy decision. So I said, I don't see that having a name, the only thing you have is your guilt by association now. If you live in a state, West Virginia's gone from completely a D state to completely an R state. So if they're looking by guilt by association, then it makes it harder for you in West Virginia with a D by your name. But you know, I've seen that the state of West Virginia was overwhelmingly Democratic, voted for Arch Moore, who was a Republican. They have voted for Cecil Wonder, who was a Republican. They voted for Ronald Reagan, who was a Republican. You know, so there was always an independent streak. And my state's always been very fiscally conservative, which I've been very much aware of, and I've always been very hawkish on the financial conditions of the state. And I said, my grandfather would always tell me, Joe, be very careful with your finances because unmanaged debt will lead you to make cowardly decisions. The old adage saying, robbing Peter to pay Paul, exactly correct.
But does it feel lonely, though, to be with a D behind your name, and the Democrats who nationally criticize you and say, well, where does he really stand? You have the Republicans lobbying for years to get you on their side. Mm-hmm. You have a state that's turned red. Yeah. Does it get lonely?
Oh, it's pretty lonely at times from the standpoint. The only thing that gives me the confidence to continue knowing what I'm doing is this one thing. If I can go home and explain it, I can vote for it. If I can't go home and explain it, I can't vote for it. So take the D and take the R and take all the identities away. That's exactly how I'm going to react as a public policymaker. I've never changed that. So I just never put much stock in having an identification of a political party that was going to control me or rule me. They don't. So the only thing up here people want, basically from a leadership standpoint, whether it be a Chuck Schumer or Mitch McConnell, they want 51. They want 51 senators to have a D by their name or an R by their name. And the reason for that means they set the agenda. That gives them the power, and it's a business power. Gives them more chances to have more money come in supporting them because they can set the agenda that might be favorable or unfavorable.
But you have a lot of power, though, with...
The power I've had, I mean, I just didn't, doing my job, I fell in it.
But the fact that people need you, they need your vote on certain issues,
I've told them, and it's not something I've sought out. I don't wish this on anybody. But the bottom line is, if you fall in that category, don't change who you are. I didn't seek it out and says, oh, now the Senate is split, so boy, if I do this, I can really be powerful. I didn't do that at all. I just found myself waking up one day, we had a 50-50 Senate. And it stayed 50-50 for the longest time ever in the history of the United States of America. We've never been split that long. So with that, I just says, guys, you got to do this. You can't just be one person make the decision for all the people on the caucus and your caucus or against this caucus. I said, guys, wait a minute. I haven't changed. I'm voting the same way I voted when I got here. I voted the same way I voted 42 years ago when I started in the House of Delegates. I haven't changed. I'm not going to change now. If you don't like the way I vote, and I'm not voting enough hardcore Democratic way for you, go out and elect more liberals. I'm not liberal. I'm a centrist, realist. I understand what I've got to do. I understand what I think will help our country, but most importantly, help the citizens of my state.
Are you tiring of Washington, of the political gamesmanship of both sides fighting each other?
That. Yeah.
Talk about that.
After a while. Well, it just wears on you. After a while, you want to. But then let me tell you, you get a glimmer. Let me tell you, I worked for 3 years trying to get the pension and retirement for my miners in my state. All over the country, mining. People that produced energy for over a century, 100 years. And they were promised, every lump of coal that was ever sold, there was an amount that's supposed to go towards a retirement and pension plan. That was the deal. And then these companies go bankrupt, they got nothing. So we fought for 3 years. Finally, you get that. And you change people's lives. Now they have health care that's guaranteed to them. They've got a pension that they worked and paid for and earned that's going to be taken care of now and make sure they get it. So some of the things just changed people's lives. And yeah, that's rewarding. So in the United States Senate, I can do something that's you have to have a lot of patience, takes a while, it wears you out at times. But when you have success, you can change millions and millions of people's lives.
Is there something that is holding you back also from deciding to run for re-election?
No, not really. Not really. Like you said, you always go through ups and downs, this and that, and what's encouraging, what's discouraging. But at the end of the day, you can do an awful lot of good if you're in public policy. I never forget when I was a small child watching John Kennedy campaign everything. And I saw what your country can do for you, what you can do for your country. And he would always say, public calling is noblest of all professions. Because it's really a calling. It's public service. It's not self-service. The public has to determine who's getting into it for themselves or who's getting into it to serve them. That's a democracy. It's a representative form of democracy. And we speak for the people. We don't speak for ourselves. But you try to. If I have information, I've got to go back and basically explain why I'm doing or what I'm doing. And if I can do that, I can live with myself. And then you have President Biden. And I've said this. Everybody should say a prayer every day for whoever the president is. You want them to succeed. If you want your country to succeed and you want democracy and freedom to succeed, you better make sure that the president, and if you're in a position, elected officials, a senator, a congressman, or whatever, that you can help that happen, you should do it. And it shouldn't be a political party saying, oh, no, they're on the other team. There's only one team, the American team, okay? You might have different sides that you're basically trying to draw strength from to make the team better, but there's only one team. And that's what I don't like, what I see. No matter who the president, if that president is Donald Trump, if you're a Democrat, you're not supposed to like Donald Trump. I tried to work with Donald Trump. It got to the point I just couldn't. Okay, I tried, couldn't. After about 2 or 3 years, this didn't work out. And then I saw the things unfold that were real that they say is not real. I was there, they're real. January 6th happened. The election's over, Joe Biden wins, all these. But whatever I can do to help the dialogue bring people together and bring the country together, I'm going to be part of that.